Hello everyone, welcome back for part 2 of lesson 6 of the course Basics of Deep Learning. So after autoencoders, we will now look at GANs, namely Generative Adversarial Networks. So we are still in an unsupervised framework where we have only access to a dataset and no labels. But now the idea is quite different from what we did with autoencoder. The idea behind GANs is to train two separate networks, namely a generator, G, over there, which take as input random vectors, so noise, like a Gaussian random variable, and we generate an image, like this. Now, this is one part of the GAN, the generator. The other part of the GAN, the other network, is the discriminator, D, and the task of the discriminator will be to classify images whether they are real or fake. So in order to do that, you will take a small batch of a few real samples from your dataset, a few fake samples from your generator. You will create this as a batch that you feed to your discriminator. And now you have a typical supervised learning task, because you know which image is coming from the real dataset and which image is coming from your generator. So these are your new labels, if you want, real and fake. So this was proposed in this paper by Goodfellow and co-authors. Okay, so the learning of the GAN is a bit tricky. So the discriminator, again, it's always called D here, it's a classifier. So you will interpret D of X as the probability for X to be a real sample. So we saw classifier a lot already in this course, so you should be able to encode a discriminator very easily. The generator, it's a bit more tricky because it takes as input a Gaussian random variable, so a random vector, and it will produce a fake sample, so an image, for example. So now, these two networks will have two different optimizers in order to update their weight, and you will alternate your learning by first improving the parameter of D when G is fixed, and then improving the parameter of G when D is fixed. So when the generator is fixed, the learning of the discriminator is relatively easy. It's a standard learning process for a binary classification. So if you interpret D of X here as the probability of X to be a real sample, this means that you have a sigmoid layer at the end of D, and then you can use a binary cross entropy loss, as we saw. The learning of the generator is a bit more subtle, because it's hard to evaluate the performance of the generator. So a good generator would be a generator which is able to create fake samples that resembles to samples in the dataset. In order to evaluate the performance of the generator, we will use indeed the discriminator. So the task of the generator will be to maximize instead of minimizing the loss of the discriminator. So the performance of the generator is directly evaluated thanks to the discriminator by maximizing the loss of the discriminator. So let's be a little bit more formal. So first start with the easy part, which is the learning of the discriminator. So again, the task of the discriminator is to distinguish real points from fake points in a given batch. So this is your data set. This is the fake point generated by your generator. Now, let's say that the last layer of your discriminator is a sigmoid layer. Then learning of D is done thanks to the binary cross entropy, which is written here. Each time you have a real point that that's here. So you have label 1 if you want. Then you are taking the log of the probability. So d of xn is interpreted as a probability. And each time you have a fake sample, you have a label 0, for example, you are taking the log of 1 minus the probability, d of g of n. Okay, so this loss is a function of both the discriminator and the generator. But here, we are only learning the generator g, the discriminator d, sorry, when g is fixed. So this star is trying to minimize this binary cross entropy, so taking the arg mean of this this function. And again, what it means in practice is that d will be a neural network with some weight, and you will do a gradient descent algorithm on the weight of the gradient, trying to minimize this loss. Again, the generator here is fixed. So now let's see the learning of the generator. So again, the task of the generator is to fool the discriminator. So this means that now the discriminator is fixed, and it's telling you how good the generator is or not. So now, in order to fool the discriminator, what you want is to maximize exactly this formula over there. So in order to make the life of the discriminator as hard as possible. So you see that in this formula here, the first term in the sum does not depend on the generator at all, since we are trying to maximize this with respect to g. You can remove this term, and you see that you obtain this simple version. So you are maximizing the parameter of the generator in order to maximize this loss of the discriminator. So in practice, most of the time we are not maximizing exactly this formula, but replacing this formula, so this minus log of 1 minus, by simply a log. So first thing to notice is that you are not the monotonicity of the function is the same, and indeed here is a plot of the function minus log 1 minus d in red. On the log d, okay, the surrogate function we want to maximize here as a function of d. So we are replacing the red curve here by the black curve over there. So why is that? One intuition you can have is that at the beginning, the generator will have, it will be very hard for the generator to generate sensible fake, let's say, images. So the discriminator will very easily detect that these images are basically random noise and are not coming from the dataset. So this means that this quantity, remember that this is the probability, evaluated by the discriminator that this sample is real, so this will be very small. So at the beginning of the training, at least, this quantity will be very, very small. So the d parameter will be close to zero, because the probability of being a real sample will be close to zero. And you see that if you use the red curve over there, this curve is relatively flat when d is close to zero. The benefit of using the black curve compared to the red one is that here you have a much steepest curve, so that when you are computing gradient, you will tend to improve the generator much faster than using this curve. On the contrary, when the discriminator is having harder time to discriminate between fake and real, you see that here it's relatively flat, so you will not update the generator too much. Okay, so here is one very simple example we will use in the practicals for GAN for this dataset. So the dataset are just 2D points coming from these two half moons. And your task will be to generate points according to this distribution mainly. So here is the structure of the network. I'm defining two networks, the generator over there and the discriminator. So the generator is taking a vector of dimension Zdim, where this is the size of the random Gaussian vector, which is the input of my generator. So here I took 32. Then I'm applying one fully connected layer with hidden dimension, hidden dim, one nonlinearity, and then I'm projecting back in two dimensions because at the end, what I want is a point in the 2D space, like this. Now for the discriminator, the input will be of size 2 because I'm taking points in the 2D space, 2D space, and then I'm applying a first hidden linear layer, nonlinearity. Then I'm projecting everything to dimension 1, and here is the sigmoid because I want to do binary classification. So here is the training loop for my very simple model. So these are the basic batch size, learning rates, and number of epochs. You see that now I'm defining two different optimizers, one for the generator and one for the discriminator. So I'm using ADAM for both of them, but you notice that on the same learning rate, but the parameters here are different. Here I will update the parameter of the generator. Here I will update the parameter of the discriminator. Now the training loop is done here. So X is my NumPy array containing the data. So here I'm just shuffling my 2D points, transforming it into NumPy and making batches over there for a number of epochs. Now the first block over there corresponds to improving the discriminator. So in order to do that, I need first to create a fake batch. I have the real batch over there, but I need to create a fake batch. For this, I need first to define a random vectors, which will be the input of my generator. So my fake batch is computed here. Now I'm computing the score given by my current discriminator on the real batch and on the fake batch, and I'm computing explicitly the binary cross-entropy loss over there. So this is minus torch, the logarithm of 1 minus d on the fake, and minus log d on the real. And then once I computed the loss, so this is the loss associated to the discriminator wants to minimize this, so I'm putting all my gradient to zero, doing one backward optimizer d steps. So this block will improve the parameter of my D network. Now I need to do the same thing but for the generator. So this is done over there. So again, I'm creating a new fake batch where Z are random Gaussian variables. This is my fake batch. In order to evaluate now the performance of my generator, I need to pass this fake batch through my discriminator, so the current discriminator. And now the loss, okay, remember the loss is written here. It's you are trying to maximize the log of the output of your discriminator. Since PyTorch is minimizing, I'm putting a minus here, and this is the log of the output of my discriminator. And again, putting the gradient to zero, loss backward, optimizing the parameters of the generator. So you see that I'm alternating between improving the discriminator over there and improving the generator over there for each batch. Now here is what you will obtain for the loss curves. So you have two curves corresponding to both the generator and the discriminator. And the first thing you need to notice is now since the generator and the discriminator are competing against each other, you do not see a loss which is smoothly decreasing. In particular, at the beginning, you have a huge oscillation, and then it seems to have converged to an equilibrium. But this is something which is true in general, and we will see it in the practicals, that there is no guarantee at all that your network will stabilize to a given equilibrium. So it might very well be that if you do not choose the right parameter, you end up with oscillation and no convergence at all. So here is an example of what you obtain with this simple GAN fitting the double moon dataset. So at the beginning, you see, so this is a small movie of the sample generated by the generator as you are running more and more epochs. So at the beginning, the generator is just doing random noise, so in the center of the image. And then you see that the generator will learn as it gets better and better, the shape, the proper shape is asked to learn from the dataset. And at the end, you end up with two kind of half moon like this. So again, these are only the fake samples generated by the generator. Now there is a very famous problem with GANs. So the first one is that it might oscillate and not converge. The second one is what is called a mode collapse. And you can have an intuition of it rather easily. So what you'd like to do in a GAN architecture is to find the best generator against any discriminator. But indeed, you are not able to solve this max-min problem. And you are alternating between finding the best generator against the current discriminator and finding the best discriminator against the current generator. And it turns out that it might be very possible that in this game between the generator and the discriminator, you end up in an equilibrium that you don't want to end up with, which is the following. The generator will only generate a subpopulation of your dataset and choose the subpopulation which is the easiest for him to generate. So another way to say the same thing is it will concentrate on a subpopulation of the dataset which is the most difficult to classify for the discriminator. So here is one example of mode collapse on MNIST, so the digit. So you see that these are digits generated by a generator from a GAN. And you probably see here what it means for a GAN to be in an equilibrium where you have a mode collapse. Namely, the fraction, you see a lot more once on this picture than the fraction of ones which are present in the MNIST dataset. And the reason is fairly simple to understand. For a generator, it should be quite easy to generate a fake one which is almost indistinguishable from a real one. And for example, so on this picture, perhaps you don't see that many five or perhaps eight, which might be harder digit to generate in the sense that a discriminator will have an easier task in discriminating a fake eight from a real one. So one way to deal with this mode collapse is by if you have access to labels, like for example, so if you are not anymore in an unsupervised setting, you can use these labels inside your GAN architecture. Basically, this is what we will do in the practicals. We'll give, in addition to the 2D points, the color corresponding to the pink or yellow here of the point. And you can give this color both to the generator. So now you will ask the generator to generate a 2D points of color pink or of color yellow. And you can also ask the discriminator to say, okay, I'm giving you a yellow, sorry, pink point or a yellow point. Do you think it's a true or a fake point? So you can use both the labels as input for your generator and your discriminator. We will see that if you do not have access to the labels, so if you are still in an unsupervised setting, it's still possible using a technique called InfoGAN to use only the information that in this setting, for example, you have two different clusters. So we will see this more in the practicals, but here is the picture, a movie of an InfoGAN in action, where the only information you are adding to your GAN is telling the GAN that there are two type of points, yellow and pink, and then the GAN is able to figure by himself which points belong to which cluster. So this is exactly very similar to a clustering algorithm, which is another unsupervised learning algorithm, where the InfoGAN is learning the color of the two different points. So it's on here you see the output of the generator, which generate now 2D points plus a color, so yellow or pink, which is very well associated to one of the two half moon. One very short point about convolutional GAN. So if you want to use GANs with images, you know that when you are dealing with images, you'd like to use convolutional layers, so convolutional neural networks. And it turns out that adapting the architecture of CNN into the framework of GANs turn out to be quite difficult. So this is an excerpt from this paper written in 2015, and which is the first paper where the author were able to use CNN architecture to generate fake images. And here are the basic rules that emerge from this paper if you want to use convolutional layers into your GAN. So you need to replace each pooling layers with trilled convolutions. So we didn't see what sorry, trilled convolutions are convolution where you are moving the kernel not only by one a stride of one, but by a stride of more than one, so in the discriminator. And so this will decrease the size of your image, so doing this kind of same thing as a pooling layer. And for the generator, you need to replace the pooling layer by trilled transpose convolution. So this transpose convolution, we didn't see what it is, so you have to have a look at it if you want to go further in this direction. You need to use batch norm both in D and G. The batch norm, we only saw it in the first practical when you used ResNet. but we didn't speak about that batch norm layer in details during this course. You need to remove all fully connected hidden layers. In the generator, you use ReLU activation except for the output, which is a hyperbolic tangent. And for the discriminator, you need to use a leaky ReLU for all layers. So this is just a warning to tell you that if you want to use GAN with images, it's not that easy. And you need to have a look at the literature in order to get the best possible practice. So let's see now what we will do in the practicals about GANs. So I'm opening the notebook. The first thing I do is just try to reproduce the first curve for the losses. So I'm generating my points. So this is the training data set. So I'm using scikit-learn to do that. I'm using GPU. So just to check. Okay. Now, since the training is taking a bit of time, I will launch it and come back here. So here, you see exactly the code I gave you in the lesson for the generator here. With an input, I will take a vector of size 32, and the output will be of size 2, point in 2D. The discriminator is taking a point in 2D and outputting probability after the sigmoid layer. I'm putting everything on the GPU. And now I'm running this for 500k pots. So you see that it's taking a little bit of time. So again, since you have two networks and you want to alternate between optimizing the weight of the generator and the weight of the discriminator, you need to define two optimizers, optimizer G and optimizer D. So I'm taking Adam for both of them, but the first one will update the parameter of the generator, the second one will update the parameter of the discriminator. Now here is exactly the training loop we discussed in the lesson. So you see that I'm running it for 500 epochs. I'm shuffling everything. So here I'm just adding, I want to keep track of the loss to see whether I'm converging or not. The first thing I'm doing here is improving the discriminator D. And here I'm improving the generator G, and I'm keeping track of all the losses. So I will come back to this. Let's see if it did converge. Oh. Okay, so this is not at all the curves I obtained on my slide. Remember, I obtained things like that. And this is one example where you do not have convergence. You see that both losses for your discriminator and your generator are indeed oscillating a lot, so it did not converge. And if you see what are the points generated by your generator, it doesn't fit at all the data which is in white over there. So here I'm helping you and I'm saying try again with a smaller, bigger learning rack actually. So this is what I will do here. And we need to wait a little bit. So we can comment during the training, the training loop which is written here. So here, how do you improve the discriminator? First, you need to create a fake batch by passing your Gaussian random variable through the generator, compute The estimated probability by your current discriminator on the real batch and on the fake batch. Compute the loss. This is again on nothing else than the binary cross entropy loss, where I'm taking log of 1 minus the probability on the fake and the log of the probability on the real. Putting all my gradient to zero, loss backward, compute the gradient, doing one step of optimization, but only for the parameter d. So here, in all this step, the generator g is fixed. So this is just to keep track of the loss over one epoch. Now here, I'm doing the same thing, but for the generator. So for the generator, I need to create a fake batch, taking random Gaussian vectors as input. In order to evaluate the performance of my generator, I'm using my discriminator. So I'm passing this fake batch through my discriminator, obtaining the estimated probability of being a real on the fake, then computing a loss. And do not forget to put a minus here because remember that G is trying to maximize the loss of the discriminator, but since PyTorch is minimizing, you need to put a minus here, and then zero grad, loss backward, one state of optimizer, but only for the generator. Okay, so it. Okay, so you see that now it did converge, and the big oscillation here are because I started in probably in a. So in a bad situation because I did not reinitialize my network. So this is why it's different from the curve in the course, but you should be able to obtain the same curve as in the course if you reinitialize the network. And here you see that your generator is doing a much better job than it used to. So again, in white, you have the real data set, and in black, you have fake points generated by your generator. And now that you have a generator, you can even generate more points than what you have in your original data set, and you obtain something like that. So you see, it's not completely perfect. I mean, there are still points which are over there, which shouldn't. But you are fitting pretty well the two half moon like this. Okay, so now comes the part of the where you will need to code. The first modification is conditional GAN. So remember now we are not anymore in a supervised setting. In an unsupervised setting, sorry, we are in a supervised setting. So I'm adding now labels to my dataset. So now my dataset will be this half moon with a color which is black, and this half moon which with a color which is white. And now I will try to understand this paper, which presents conditional GAN. So here, you recognize exactly the loss we discussed in the course, and here you see that it minimizes log 1 minus d, log d. Okay. Now here is the modification illustrated on this image. So in addition. In addition to the sample X, you have some ex extra information Y. So in our case, this will be just the label if it's a point which is black or white. A one-hot actually encoding of this label. And now you see that here is the modification proposed by the author. The discriminator will take as input both your sample, fake or real, plus the associated label. So based on both the sample and its associated label, it must still predict whether it's a fake or a real sample. The generator is also modified, and it will take now this Z, which is a random Gaussian vector, plus a label, and it will generate a point of this given label. So both the discriminator and the generator will have as input the one-hot encoding of the label. So here is a new definition for the generator and the discriminator. And you see that the main difference is that now for the generator, I'm taking an input which is of dimension Zdim plus labeldim. And labeldim is equal to 2 because I have two classes and I'm taking a one-hot encoding of this class. So here you see that the first thing I'm doing is I'm concatenating my input, which is the random Gaussian vector, plus the one-hot encoding of the label, and passing it through my network, which is again superposition of linear layer. For the discriminator, same thing. I'm taking now a 2D point plus a one-hot encoding of the label. First thing I'm doing, I'm concatenating everything, and then I'm passing it through these different layers. And at the end, I'm still predicting whether it's a fake or a real sample through this sigmoid layer. Now, okay, you will need to modify the training loop written here in order to take in this additional information inside the structure of your GAN by doing a conditional GAN. So here I rewrote mostly what we did for the generic GAN over there. But now you see that there is one modification. So here are the two optimizers for the conditional generator, conditional discriminator. I want the loss for the discriminator and generator. Now X are still, sorry, the 2D points, and Y correspond to the labels. So it's over there. And I mean, you need to take these labels into in addition to the previous setting. So the loss when you are updating the discriminator will not be modified. So this is just a copied from what we did before. But of course, you need to compute the output of D on the fake and the output of D on the real. And again, the loss for the generator is not modified either. I mean, the only thing that is modified here is the architecture of the generator and the discriminator, but the learning phase, if you want, is not modified. So this is why I reproduced here exactly what we did before. So it's probably a good time for you to stop here and to see if you are able to do that before proceeding to the next step, which will be InfoGAN. Okay, so here is a very simplified version of an algorithm presented in this paper, which is a bit harder to read than the one on conditional GAN. But this time, we are still in an unsupervised setting where you do not have access to the labels. So we are in the same setting as here, where you have only these points, no color. The only thing that we know is that there are two clusters, and we'd like the algorithm to find the two clusters corresponding to the two half moon. So how to do this? Here is one way to do that. So the idea is to provide to the generator still a label. So what you will do is, as in the conditional GAN, you will take a generator that take, so it's written over there, a random Gaussian vector plus one autocoding of the label. The first thing you do, you concatenate and you pass it through the network and you obtain a 2D point. So the generator in the info GAN is basically the same as for the conditional GAN. But now you cannot use the same strategy for the discriminator because you do not have labels on the real samples. So the discriminator cannot take as input the label because you have no access to the labels for real samples. So what you will do is instead modify the discriminator, and this is done here, in order to output both a prediction that your sample is real or fake, and also a prediction of the label. So you see that now I have an output here and an estimated label here. So my discriminator will output two things. The first one is interpreted as the probability that what I gave him as input is a real or fake sample. And the second one is an estimation of the label, whether it belongs to one cluster or to the other. Then you need to learn the weight of the discriminator. And in order to do that, so for the output, you can do as before. And for this one, you need to think a little bit, but you can use the fake samples generated by your generator. Why is that? Because for the fake samples, you ask the generator to take as input random Gaussian noise on the given label and produce one point. So you know which label you started with. So for the discriminator, on a fake sample, you know what is its corresponding label. So you can learn this part, this estimated label of the discriminator on the fake samples only and not on the real ones. And you will see that it will help you a lot and give you a very good result in terms of clustering, even in a case where you do not have access to the true labels which are here commented in this part of the code. So you need to be a little bit careful because here are, for example, two results I obtained with exactly the same architecture I presented of simplified InfoGAN, where you see that so these are points generated by two different after two different training of the same algorithm, same network. So you see that after this training loop, the network learned a kind of weird separation of my data according to this line. So it put all the points below this line in white and all the points above this line in black and tried to fit the half moon. So it's not doing a very good job over there and over there in terms of fitting. And there is also a gap over there and here. So this is possible. And here is another, way where it's almost correct, what you wanted, but the network is cutting your original dataset in two clusters according to this line, where all the points above this line are in white and all the points below this line are in black. And otherwise it fits to the two half moon, but you see that it's making quite a few errors over there. And if you want to see a successful case, so here is one case where the InfoGAN algorithm learned exactly the cluster I had in mind when I gave him, and so corresponding to the white half moon over there and the black half moon over there, and you see that it's not making any error in between the two half moon. So the performance are quite good in this case. Okay, that's it for today's lesson. Good luck with the practicals. Bye.